On November 17, 2024, a tsunami struck the state of Washington.
Wait, I live in Washington, and I didn't see or hear a tsunami, let alone reports about damage that it caused, or even mentions of it on the news. What do you mean a tsunami occurred?
And that is where you would be wrong. A tsunami did truly occur that day, just not where you would expect on the shoreline of the Pacific Ocean. Instead, this tsunami occurred at a spot more than 200 miles inland from the ocean, an elevation of 1,282 feet above sea level. There, on the western shoreline of Lake Roosevelt at a spot 4.5 miles west-southwest of the town of Kettle Falls, a portion of the shoreline began to slowly creep forward. This quickly escalated until, at 8 a.m. local time, a 1,130-foot-long and 460-foot-wide section of the shoreline greatly accelerated, collapsing all at once into Lake Roosevelt. This landslide, which had a volume I estimate to be between 1 million and 1.6 million cubic meters of rock, quickly displaced an equivalent volume of water upon entering the lake, causing water to lurch upwards and generating a large wave. This wave initially had a maximum height of 30 feet and expanded outwards at a speed of 38 miles per hour in all directions, decreasing in size with increasing distance. 90 seconds later, the wave struck the eastern shoreline, detaching and overturning a dock at Rickey Point. Moments later, the wave ran up 21 feet above the lake level 6/10 of a mile to the north-northeast. A lesser wave height then struck additional patches of shoreline further away. What had just occurred was the largest landslide-generated tsunami to strike Lake Roosevelt since 1969, a whopping 55 years ago. Yet, what had just occurred was, surprisingly enough, not a unique event. Since Lake Roosevelt was created by the damming of the Columbia River in 1941, 23 similar landslide-generated tsunamis have occurred, some far surpassing the wave height just witnessed. In fact, these prior tsunami waves range in terms of their maximum height anywhere from 16 feet all the way up to 65 feet high. Before I elaborate onto why these past landslides in addition to the latest landslide and tsunami occurred, I will first address the current situation. You see, the landslide which we just witnessed may not necessarily be the last one we soon see. The associated hillside that just collapsed was detected to still be slowly moving, giving additional risk that more likely smaller, albeit still fairly sizable landslides could soon occur, thus generating additional tsunami waves. While I cannot independently verify the following claim, some locals have posted about hearing additional crashing sounds since the main slide occurred, from what I interpret to be large chunks of rock falling into Lake Roosevelt from the landslide scar. In other words, please be very cautious and do not go anywhere near the active landslide site. After all, a similar landslide struck a mere 1,200 feet north of the latest landslide's edge during April 1953. Following this, across the next 5 months, 10 additional landslides and thus tsunamis were generated due to additional collapses from the same site. In fact, of the 14 prior landslides to strike this very section of Roosevelt Lake, only one could not be linked to triggering an additional collapse, with that being the last slide in August 1953. During the last glacial period, the entirety of what would later become Lake Roosevelt was covered by up to half a mile thick of glacial ice. As this glacier retreated, it left behind large amounts of the scraped rock and sediment it carried, leaving it behind along with material transported by glacial meltwater in deposits referred to as glacial drift. Glacial drift, due to its poorly sorted and unstratified nature, is very structurally weak, and since this rock type lined large parts of what would become Lake Roosevelt's shoreline, it created a problem. When Lake Roosevelt was created in 1941, the water table increased, causing water to soak into the bottom sections of several unstable areas of glacial drift. This destabilized those regions, but also at the same time the mass of water in the lake held up the bottom section of the slope. Thus, when water was released to generate electricity, the lake level dropped. Without the water holding up the bottom of an unstable region, it finally collapsed, creating an inland tsunami. The reason why so many landslides occurred between 1944 and 1953 is a combination of how soon after the creation of the lake it was at the time, alongside with the fact that initially there was not a limit to how much water could be drawn down in a single day. After the addition of a rule that created a maximum daily decrease in lake level of 18 inches a day, the number of hazardous landslides and tsunamis have substantially decreased. However, in the case of the latest landslide, I interpret that a long-term destabilization of the relevant slope due to changing water levels had occurred, rather than having a singular short-term cause. As a final note, I would like to thank my new YouTube channel member, Mark Strawn, for supporting my work.